In the love and power of God, we meet and welcome to worship with one United Church of Christ. If this is your first time here, you are welcome. Whether you come here frequently, you are welcome. If you are a member or a friend of one UCC, you are welcome, and it is a joy to be together. The bulletin that goes along with today's service can be found, as always, in the podcast section of our website at oneucc.org. It was also sent out in the weekly church email on Thursday and shared to Facebook. And depending what time you watch this video, it's also linked in the video description. We highly encourage you to download it and look through it, highlighting a couple of the announcements in the bulletin. Save the date for November 7th, a soup and barbecue sale here at church. Also, the crop walk is coming up in a couple of weeks, and we're looking for volunteers to begin a caring ministry. As evidenced by the communion table behind us, we are having communion today. If you have not yet gathered your bread and drink, we invite you to do so now. Hit pause and come back to the service. The hearts behind us continue to multiply, unfortunately, and they remember the over 8,000 people in Pennsylvania who have died from COVID-19. You can't see all the hearts. They're also going down the center aisle of the church. They are kind of everywhere. These hearts are a call to prayer and action. One action that we can do, it's a very simple one this week, is the Department of Health for our state has released an app called COVID Alert PA. If you have a smartphone or a tablet, I encourage you to download the app. The more of us who do it, the more data they can get about contact tracing, which is hugely important now. If you're tired of the way things are, if you would like to go out to eat and have somebody else wash your dishes and you haven't done so since March, like me, get the app, participate in contact tracing, help keep everybody safe. If that's not something that you can do, continue to wash hands, wear masks, and check in with one another. Also in the vein of public service announcements, this is a great time to make your plan to vote. Please know where your voting location is. If you're not registered to vote and you can, please register and figure out whether you're going to do mail-in or in-person vote. My biggest political opinion is that everyone should vote. I'm not concerned with how a person votes, but that a person does vote. Our democracy is built on the voice of the people, and when the people don't speak through voting, we all suffer. So please start planning for Election Day now. November 3rd will be here before you know it. And finally, thank you for all the support of the ministry of this congregation. Thank you, and please continue to send in your financial contributions. Most importantly, thank you for the ways that you are embodying Jesus' love in the places where you are. That is the most important piece of being a disciple. And so, friends, we gather in the presence of God who has created us and the world with fierceness and power. We gather in the presence of Jesus Christ, who promises to be with us through every trial and every celebration. We gather with the Holy Spirit, who sustains us and calls us to give ourselves more completely to the fullness of God. In the presence of our triune God, let us worship now with joy.
Worship His Majesty.
In search of a better way of living, a way that honors more fully the majesty and beauty of God, may we offer our prayer of confession together. Gracious God, you constantly invite us to draw near to you, to hear your life-giving words of hope. We confess we are slow to listen and slower to learn. Instead, we are frantically running about, seeking to be productive and find our worth in what we can do and create. We are worried and distracted by many things, few of which have much to do with you. Forgive our inattention and our busyness. We pray for the grace to be slowed down and to focus on what is important. Help us to learn the better part attending to your life-giving way of life. Amen. Grace finds us in many forms and often when we least expect it. For this, we are forgiven of our sins. We are also challenged to live differently in the light of the grace we have received. May we go and live as those changed by divine love. Amen. Once again, may we pray. Jesus, we sit metaphorically at your feet today and listen to your words. In them, may we hear your voice of love, claim, and calling. Help us not just to listen, but to live the extravagant grace of your message. Amen. If we can spot a leader by what a person does, will we say someone who cleans and cares for feet is a leader in our society? Likely not. Leaders are important people who make decisions, sprint through busy schedules, hand out commands and declarations, and have lots of meetings, right? Not always. Today we meet an example of leadership that is humble and incredibly powerful. Mary of Bethany, the learning leader. As we hear pieces of her story, listen carefully for how she models both leadership and discipleship. Her story begins in the Gospel of Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 38 through 42. While Jesus and his disciples were traveling, Jesus entered a village where a woman named Martha welcomed him as her guest. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his message. By contrast, Martha was preoccupied with getting everything ready for the meal. So Martha came to him and said, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to prepare the table all by myself? Tell her to help me." The Lord answered, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. One thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the better part. It won't be taken from her." And the story of Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus picks up again in John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, home of Lazarus, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Lazarus and his sisters hosted a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who joined him at the table. Then Mary took an extraordinary amount, almost 3/4 of a pound, of a very expensive perfume made out of pure nard. She anointed Jesus' feet with it, then wiped his feet dry with her hair. The house was filled with the aroma of the perfume. Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, complained, "This perfume was worth a year's wages. Why wasn't it sold and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He carried the money bag and would take what was in it. Then Jesus said, "Leave her alone. This perfume was to be used in preparation for my burial, and this is how she used it. You will always have the poor among you, but you won't always have me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Strong, you are sure, you are alive.
Feet are rather gnarly body parts, aren't they? They're funny looking, they can be rough and calloused, toes bend at stranger and stranger angles as we age. Feet are interestingly shaped. Middle toes in some people can be long, while big toes stumpy and short. None of this is to mention bunions, toenails, and the wear and tear of daily life. Since July, I've been hiking the Appalachian Trail through Pennsylvania in sections, and in the 10% of the AT I've done in Roxylvania, let me tell you, whatever aspirations I had of being a foot model are gone, thanks to some righteous blisters and calluses I've developed stumbling through the rock fields in the northern part of our state. Feet are humble things. Yet feet, specifically Jesus' feet, feature prominently in both of our scripture readings this week. And feet are a good metaphor to talk about our next example of leadership, the learning leader. Today we run across Mary of Bethany, sister of Martha and Lazarus. Mary's connection with Jesus' feet in both stories exemplifies her modeling of discipleship and leadership. Tracing the story of Mary and her siblings through the Gospels is fascinating, as they were extremely close friends of Jesus. The first time we meet Mary and Martha is in Luke's Gospel with the story we heard from Luke 10. Jesus and his disciples have arrived at the sisters' home, and Martha is frantically running around getting the meal ready for the teacher and his companions. Mary, on the other hand, is sitting at Jesus' feet and listening to him teach. Martha, irritated by her sister's behavior, complains to Jesus and asks him to tell Mary to help her. Jesus refuses to do so, gently telling Martha, she's the one doing the wrong things, and only one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the better part, and it won't be taken from her. The story in Luke ends there, yet the story of these siblings continues in John's Gospel. In John 11, we next run into Martha and Mary with their brother Lazarus, who had just died. If you aren't familiar with this story, John 11 is definitely worth the read. Our second scripture for this week, however, is the aftermath of the raising of Lazarus in John 12. Having found life again, Mary and Martha and Lazarus host a dinner party for Jesus and his disciples. Once again, Mary does something odd. During the meal, she takes a whole lot of nard, an aromatic and prized but really smelly perfume, and anoints Jesus' feet with it, drying them with her hair. Again, someone gets upset by Mary's actions, although this time it's Judas, who argues the money Mary spent on the perfume could have been better used to help the poor. Once again, Jesus stands up for Mary's gesture, noting how Mary showed extravagant love toward him, especially as he was nearing his death. Sitting at Jesus' feet, Mary is an unusual woman. In the reading from Luke, Mary is acting in ways that were culturally inappropriate for her time. Women in the first century were not to sit at the master's feet, the teacher's feet, listening along with the men. Women in the first century were to be embodying hospitality, as Martha was doing, and giving the men some time to learn. Yet Mary's behaviors were welcomed, accepted, and defended by Jesus. He praised Mary's choices, reminding Martha that only one thing was necessary. That one thing was to listen and to learn. Anointing Jesus' feet. Mary is an unusual disciple. Mary seems to have learned much at the Master's feet, as evidenced by our story today in John. This reading from John 12 is incredibly rich in meaning and nuance. Mary proves herself in it to be the ideal disciple ahead of even the 12. She alone grasps Jesus' identity and what will happen to him. She alone knows the voice of her shepherd and without a word responds to his presence with a gesture of extravagant love. She alone demonstrates costly, controversial love before Jesus even washes his disciples' feet and commands them to love one another. Maybe he got that idea from Mary. Whatever she heard from Jesus earlier, Mary has understood only one thing is necessary: to learn and to love. Mary's example of leadership is intriguing. She is both a leader and a learner. When we think about leaders today, we often think that the leader is the expert in the room who has all the answers. While having a leader who is informed is a very good thing, it is more important for the leader to be the person in the room who has all the right questions. As much as a leader might be known as an expert in their field, they don't know everything. For example, a business leader might be well-versed in organizational dynamics, management, the specific product that the business creates, but they don't know everything that there is to know about those consuming their product, about the community where the business is located, or about the needs and wants of their employees. A leader is someone who recognizes there is always so much more to learn, and who asks the right questions to learn and to help their team learn along with them. Mary exemplified being a learning leader, especially one who follows Jesus. As we seek to be leaders like Jesus was and is and cultivate God's future right here and now, Mary shows us a powerful way to embody leadership. The way she interacted with Jesus' feet is a metaphor for the sort of leadership she calls forth. We can't be too proud to sit at Jesus' feet and learn, or to anoint them, touching his rough, calloused toes and wiping away their grit. Being a leader requires humility in that we declare we don't know it all, understand it all, and are willing to be changed by learning. When we are learners, we are engaged in the learning process, which is a humbling process. That process asks us to be open to feedback and constructive criticism, to tear apart what we thought we knew and how we once did things, to embrace a more expansive knowledge and greater challenges. In adulthood, outside of designated learning environments, we become set in our ways and don't find opportunities or have opportunities to receive constructive feedback on how we can improve ourselves. Our ideas about life, faith, and being human aren't questioned, tested, or refined. Without a process of learning, we stagnate and become complacent in who we are as people and as disciples. Mary calls our awareness to the importance of learning in both discipleship and leadership. Learning is a process of change and growth, both of which can be exciting and scary. Learning is the one thing, though, that Jesus says is necessary. Not just in Mary and Martha's story, but all throughout all four Gospels, Jesus calls people to learn from him about God, life, and being human. He came to teach humanity something new. That newness was life-giving to some, threatening to others, and cost Jesus his life. Yet even then, in death, Jesus had one last lesson to teach us. Love is the strongest force there is in existence. When Mary sat at Jesus' feet and listened, she modeled the power of learning. When Mary anointed Jesus' feet and wiped them with her hair, she modeled the beauty and scandal of sacrificial love. Learning is pointless if we don't reveal what we've learned. In Luke 10, Mary learned, and then in John 12, she put that learning into action. Being a learning leader asks us to keep growing in our understandings of God, life, and being human, and to remember our learning isn't for our own edification, but to reveal God's beautiful, scandalous love for a hurting world. My prayers in the week ahead, may each of us intentionally seek out some new form of learning about God, life, or being human. Maybe we read a book or an article, listen to a podcast or watch a video, or have a conversation about something we didn't know before. If you do this, ask God to help you be open, humble, and ready for whatever the Spirit would show you. But don't stop there. Take that learning and use it to benefit someone else, thus revealing a piece of God's beautiful, scandalous, costly love for us all. Maybe this learning is a conversation with a loved one where you seek to understand their views instead of telling them what you think that you know about them or know about an issue. Or maybe this learning is about an issue that's challenging right now, like voter suppression. And then you pledge to vote and encourage your friends to vote as well. But before doing any of this, check in with God first. Take some time and sit at the Holy One's feet, metaphorically, and ask God to show you what you might need to learn for your sake and the sake of the world God loves. Maybe as we share in communion in a moment, pause this worship service, take a few quiet moments, and ask the Spirit what it wants you to learn. My friends in Christ, may we have the grace and humility to grow as learning disciple leaders. In the process, may we discover more powerfully the love God has for each of us, a love that sees all of our pride, our unpleasant features, a love that touches our brokenness and cares far too much to allow us to stay in painful spaces, a love that knows the necessity of learning if we are to grow into the fullness and fierceness of what God created us to be. May such love come alive in your life and at this table now, today, and in the days ahead. Amen. If you have kids, especially kids who are elementary school age or middle or high school, you know that learning is best done on a full stomach. That's true for us of all ages. At this table, we are given what we need to learn and grow as disciples and leaders. A blessing of worshiping like we are now is that we can find some form of communion that satisfies us uniquely. Normally, when we have communion in church, we have this small cube of bread and this little shot glass of grape juice. And then while they're symbolic and lovely, they're far from extravagant, especially the kind of extravagance Mary models for us today. Friends, if you haven't found your communion elements yet, please press pause and do so and find some form of bread product or water, wine, juice that is more lavish than we normally use in church. If you already have your elements in place, look over them to see if they reflect both the holiness of God and the extravagant love of Christ. And if not, go find something that better does. As much as we remember at this table Christ's sacrifice on the cross for us, we equally remember in God and Christ's extravagant, costly, beautiful, and scandalous love for us. Here our hungers are met and filled. Here we are strengthened to learn about God, life, and being human. And so come, friends, to this table of sacrifice and joy. You are welcome here. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High. It is indeed right, Holy One, to give you our thanks and praise for the myriad of ways you've been involved in our lives and in our world. You created us, placed your very breath within us, and called us your beloved people. You desired that we would turn our hearts fully to you, and yet we didn't. We turned away. You sent prophets to remind us of your love. We didn't listen. You sent warnings and signs calling us to return. We ran farther. And so you sent us yourself. Hungry for a new world you could envision, you became one of us in Jesus of Nazareth. You didn't miss your chance to reconcile us. You taught us how to turn our hearts to you. You gave us words and stories and prayers to remind us of your love. You worked miracles of abundance, healing, and welcome to show us the ways that you always invite us back to you. We are still returning. Though death took you from us when you died on the cross because of our sins, you defeated death. In your resurrection, you gave life and love back to us again. Through your Spirit, you continue giving back. Your presence nourishes us and enables us to work for the day when earth is as heaven, when all creation is free and when your will reigns supreme. All glory and honor, blessing and power be unto you, mighty God, now and forever. Amen. When we gather at this table, we remember yet another meal Jesus shared with his disciples and his friends. And in the course of that meal on the last night of his life, he took bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he gave it to them and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it to remember me." Similarly, during the course of the meal, Jesus took a cup. And again, giving thanks for it, he gave it to them and said, "This cup is a cup of the new blood, of the new covenant shed in my blood. It is given for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Each time you drink of it, remember me." May we pray. Holy Spirit, we pray for you to come into this moment and bless these gifts of bread and cup, and bless us who are gathered in your name. By your power, transform all that we offer, including ourselves, into living signs of Christ's love and sacrifice among us. Change us by your grace, so that we may more deeply embody your love for the world. We pray this in Jesus' name and through his words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, the bread that we break is for us a sharing in the body of Christ. Take and eat. The cup of blessing which we bless is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Take and drink. By what we have received from this table, gracious God, free us to live with joy. In your provision, may we find our security. In your power, may we find our hope. In your courage and claim, may we find the faith to live as your people today and always. Amen.
Forget
your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. A lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet.
May the light of God's love keep our feet close to Jesus so that we can learn from him what is necessary and what is loving. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit go with us today and always. Amen.